Subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Hello and welcome to The Print. The financial sector has been under a lot of stress for the last couple of years. The COVID-19 pandemic has added to the woes of the financial sector. The Reserve Bank of India and the government have been announcing many measures over the last few months to bring respite to financial institutions as well as to the borrowers. But have these measures worked on the ground? We have with us today Mr. Hemant Kanoria, Chairman of Sri Infrastructure Finance. Welcome, sir, and thank you for taking our time. Sir, I want to begin by asking you, that how do you think the unlock phase is progressing, and do you really see some signs of economic revival?
No, I think that some of the sectors, the revival has been there because, like FMCG companies, people who are there in the two-wheelers and all, and many of the food items and all, there has been technology companies. So technology companies never had a bad time, because during the lockdown, the only way that people could communicate to each other was through. So digitization and technology has really helped the country in the last many years that it has embarked on this particular program. So therefore, I think that all these industries have done well. But whereas in the real sector, where manufacturing and all is concerned, that some companies have started picking up, but most of the companies are still facing a problem because either they have a supply chain problems, some of the MSMEs are facing problems. And that is why I would say that, it's basically a mixed kind of a result. And primarily, most of the companies are struggling. Few companies are doing well. And that is why we see the buoyancy in the stock markets also, because of the nifty companies which are there who are having sufficient cash flows with them. So those companies are not facing problems, and technology and FMCG companies, etc. Pharma companies are also doing well.
The recent trend of now again states reintroducing lockdowns, do you think that will further exacerbate the situation?
No, definitely, because see what is happening is that now it is not, the lockdowns are not happening in a structured manner. Just for example, the West Bengal government yesterday has said that there will be a lockdown this week on Thursday and Saturday, then again next week on Wednesday. So therefore, people will not be in a position to plan out their production facilities. If they have to open their offices, they don't know that you have these abrupt openings and closures. So this is not going to be good for at least the economic activity which is there. So what I see is that at this particular juncture, and this has become a reality, and this is the new normal also, because the governments also do not know how to react to this pandemic. So sometimes whenever there is a spike in a city, so there is an overreaction. When there is no spike, then everyone thinks that your life is normal. But actually it has not normalized as yet. And unfortunately, while the government is dealing with this pandemic is something which is it is unpredictable. Like when we had the economic crisis in 2008, the global financial crisis, it was man-made, but this is not man-made. So therefore, everyone just keeps on, having the conjectures, they keep on guessing around that what is going to happen and what will happen today and what will happen tomorrow, whether a vaccination will come, whether there will be some medicines, who will get affected. No one knows that who is going to be will be affected with this, with the COVID. And someone may be severely affected, some may be mildly affected, some can come out of the problem, it can be fatal for them. So therefore, it's very, very unpredictable. So in these unpredictable times where the health is concerned, I think economy is something which can be predictable because this is man-made. So therefore, we can take certain actions which are not short-term, but it has to be medium to long-term. Because in the short term, certain solutions have to be found out because there is no other option. But we have to think about medium to long term and factor in that these openings and closures, lockdowns and unlockdowns will keep on happening. So I don't see that. Yeah, sorry. Please go ahead.
But isn't certainty a key, for manufacturing units to start reopening and even for migrant laborers to come back into towns and cities?
So it is like life, the certainty of this is as certain as life is. So, when people know that there is a certainty that, you know, when we live, there's uncertainty. People don't know when they're going to die. And there are certainties of certain things in life. So similarly, here also in pandemic, it is an antithetical balance which has to be maintained. When we do not know, when we know this pandemic is uncertain, when it is going to go down, where it is going to get affected, when it is going to spike. So on the economy side, the businesses have to be structured in a manner where they can take these ups and downs. They have to also, like, you know, each company, they have to have their modeling done that if people come in, very good. If they don't come in, then how they can survive with a very low cost. So everyone has to first of all look at reducing their costs substantially. They have to look at introducing work from anywhere policy, where the manufacturing concern, when manufacturing companies are there, where people have to come and attend, or the labor have to work on a particular project because physical work is required. So there, whatever safety measures can be taken has to be taken by those companies. And if someone gets affected, then they need to have the proper medical care. So those are the practices which has to be introduced. People which are in technology-based company or in the financial services company. So in these kind of companies, service-based companies, so many of the services can happen from home or from anywhere on the technology platform. So 70 to 80% business can be done that way. And 20 to 30% what has to be done physically, then you have to take those particular precautions. So similarly, the government also needs to now think through it, that what are the economic measures which are required to be taken in these uncertain times. So I think that would be very important for the government also to think. So, you know, the government has been thinking, they have been announcing the stimulus package, but all the stimulus package which is coming is by way of credit for businesses. I'm not talking about the poor people or the farmers or the agriculture, where cash is also being given, which is important, where food is being provided to people, which is important. I'm not saying that, I'm not undermining what the government has done there, but where businesses are concerned, the economy has to be looked at in a very different manner, because the stimulus package which is actually required for them in the measure and in the manner has still not come.
But the government will argue that, you know, given the uncertainty of the pandemic, as you also mentioned, you know, the government is possibly reserving its firepower to for a later date, so that, because they didn't really know how long this pandemic will last.
No, as you very rightly said, you know, we cannot keep the fire. It's like keeping the medicines, because people know that this is going to continue for a long time. So therefore they say that, okay, let me store the medicine. And when it becomes really bad, that time I'll use the medicine. But by that time the person has already died. So the medicine is of no use. The medicine has to be administered in the measure which is required for the person to be alive. You can't keep everything for the last day. So I think that for the government also, the amount which is required for the economic measures is not huge. It is small amounts which are required, but it has to be intelligently infused. It is required sector-wise. So like, let's suppose, for example, there is no harm in allowing a one-time restructuring for all the companies, okay, because that is not going to cost the government a single pipe. It will only bring in the companies. They can align their cash flows, and the bankers can also align their repayments depending upon the cash flow, which is but natural and normal. So there have been almost 4 months that the vacillation of the government is going on between the government and the RBI, whether they should do it, they should not do it. But I just cannot understand the reason that why can't you just implement it? You have some norms which are there. In regular course, those norms are all right. That you have a 90 days, 30 days, NPL norms, all the provisioning norms. In normal times, it is all right. But you have to align it to what the times are now. So I don't see that there is any problem in doing that. So that will at least alleviate the cash flow pressure, which is there both on the lender and the borrower. So that is one measure which can be taken. There is not one single rupee of the government which is involved in that. Now let us come to the second part, which they can do that sector wise. They can see that which sectors, what kind of problem they are having and how it can be sorted out. Some it can be deferred. Some cases the government charges and all can be just deferred, like tax payments which are there. So therefore some sector, I'm not saying that you do it across the board, but some of the sectors it can be deferred. So therefore those sectors who are struggling for cash flow, you're not providing them cash, but you have provided them the alleviation to their problem of cash flow. So therefore I think that in a country which is like a country like India, where we are not the US, we can have trillions of dollars of stimulus packages which is given to the industries, or Singapore, where they have a lot of cash which is available, which can be infused in the economy and given to the companies, we can't do it. And that's a reality. But we can therefore think in an intelligent manner and use the small capital that we have and to provide the packages, the stimulus package, in a manner which is going to have a long-term benefit to those industries, and very specific treatment is to be given.
So do you favor an across-the-board restructuring of one-time restructuring of all loans come August 31st? Or is it, you know, are you looking for only sectors which are under stress?
No, I think that basically, you see, again, when we do the sector, what is happening is that we are saying that who is choosing the sectors? The sectors are being chosen by some few whose limited understanding may confine the benefits to only few and leave out the rest who may need it. So therefore, when there is no harm in doing something, then why not do it? Like there was, when the government saw on the 22nd of March onward, when there was a lockdown, the government saw that there was no harm in doing the lockdown because at least it was a preventive measure. So they did it. It may have caused confusion. It may have caused a lot of pain to many people. Many people have suffered. So be it. But at least the government thought that it was the right step to be taken, and they did it. So similarly, I think that a one-time restructuring is not going to have any harmful effect on anyone. So if it is not going to have a harmful effect on anyone, then allow everyone. Some people may take it, some people may not take it. So leave the discretion to the lender and the borrower.
But this will not add to like the NPAs, you know, probably a year down the line if a company is not able to, you know, get back on its feet.
But today you see that as soon as it is open on the 31st of August, there will be a rush of NPLs to the banks. Then the RBI will ask the bankers, you provide for more, bring more capital. Then the government will have to provide capital. The government will say, okay, I'm bringing in capital and then you can invest in my bonds. So therefore, actually, there is no capital which has been infused. So actually, what is happening is that you are either you be in a vicious cycle on a continuous basis, or you break that vicious cycle and come on to the virtuous cycle. So that is a transition which has to be made.
What do you think of the governor's statement, you know, he made last week, where he's talking about how banks should build more than adequate capital buffers during these times and not only, you know, stick to regulatory capital requirements?
So it's a very good idea. But the point is that from where will the money come? Who's going to be investing in banks today? You see, because everyone knows that there will be NPAs which will be coming in. So let's suppose if I have to invest in a bank, or even in NBFC, I will think twice. Because I know after 31st of August, there's going to be a bloodbath. And everyone is going to face a problem. So therefore, the investors who are coming in will be really very, very brave investors.
What is your assessment of the loan moratorium on non-banking finance companies?
So again, that you see that there's not been a consistent guideline or circular. So therefore, it has been left to all the lenders to choose what they want to do. So some lenders have extended, some lenders have not extended. Whereas for us as an NBFC, because all our clients are in our MSMEs or infrastructure projects or healthcare sector, so everyone has got affected. But all our clients are business clients. So therefore, most of them, they have sought moratorium. So we have had to give them moratorium. But at the same time, we are still struggling with some of our lenders. Because it's a choice which has been given to them.
Right.
I think that because basically that is the reason why certain times, like when the government took a decision of having a lockdown on the 22nd of March, it was across the board for the whole country. If it was in a democratic manner, that okay, one day it will be allowed, 2 days this state can allow and that state, it would be again a pandemonium.
Right. And I think that moratorium, at least the second time around, a lot of banks have, you know, chosen their own way of, you know, deciding who gets the moratorium and who does not. So, what has been your, you know, view on the liquidity, the special liquidity window that the government announced under its Atmanirbhar package for NBFCs? Has it worked this time around, especially given that, you know, the earlier two attempts didn't really take off?
See, basically, it's been a good announcement by the government, but I still need to find out which are the companies who have got it. So maybe many of the AAA rated companies, people who have been in consumer financing and all the government related companies, which are in NBFCs, which are owned by the government, those have already got the measure. But I have not seen a single penny coming.
Okay. So it has not been that easy, and you know, banks have not been that open to lending to NBFCs, despite so many measures that have been announced.
See, because actually what has happened is that the government, if you are lending to an NBFC to a certain extent are shadow banks. The banks see it as a competitor also. So therefore, right, when the money is being infused through a competitor, why would the competitor like to, if I was in a bank situation, I would like most of the NBFCs to die, because then I would have less of competition. So it is but natural. How can I say that my competitor should also become as strong as me? My competitor, if it is weak or dead, I'm in a better situation. So therefore, the fallacy of this particular announcement has been that it has come, if the government had set up, just like NHB, so the government, if they had taken an institution and said, okay, through this institution, we will be lending. Let us suppose it may be LIC, saying that we will open a window to lend. They are not competitors. So we will open a window to extend the loans to NBFCs and put down criteria. I'm not saying that you don't have your criteria. You have your stringent criteria, but the person who is dispensing it must be a neutral organization. It cannot be an organization which has a self-interest in seeing that they should not have that kind of competition going on with them.
And I think the criticism of the whole package, the Atmanirbhar package, has been that the government has been over-dependent on banks, you know, to implement most of their steps, be it even the 3 lakh crore liquidity window for MSMEs or the 30,000 crore NBFC liquidity window.
And you see, banks are scared at this particular juncture because whatever that happened in the last 5-6 years, they don't want to take decisions, because if they take, they want to take absolutely safe decisions. So those kind of safe decisions can only exist in a perfect world or in a developed country. So if they go to Europe or if they go to US, it is fine. But in India, you have to take risks because we are a developing economy. And the basic idea of the government, when they had nationalized banks or when they are public sector banks, we still have 70% of the business, is to see that they also have a job to support the economy. I'm not saying that you should do reckless lending. And I don't want to say that, you see, you can do not reckless lending, but still in lending, there can be problems which can arise. So how to deal with those problems? And that is what the bankers have been doing for the last so many decades in our country. But last 5-6 years, unfortunately, the entire banking sector has moved into mathematical calculations. That if so many days, if the money does not come on the 30th day, then you are SMA1, then SMA2, then SMA. So everything is clinical. So if your blood pressure is 140, that means that you should be hospitalized and put for surgery.
So, but when do you think this risk aversion, will end for both financial institutions as well as for companies? Even companies are reluctant to borrow right now. Banks are reluctant to lend.
I don't think so that it is going to end unless the mindset change happens, that where the formula for the provisioning has to be reviewed. Because if that is not done, then the bankers will always be scared in lending. And the borrowers, when they are borrowing, they will know that if there is a, in businesses, there can be ups and downs. But whenever there is a down in the business, then the banker would want to say that it is a willful defaulter. The banker would take him into NCLT. So therefore, the borrower is also scared now because they think that why should I take a risk? Because the businesses have to go through a cycle of an up and down, because there can no one who can say that the businesses will always keep on going up. It has a cycle. So when there is a down cycle, so what could be the response of the bankers and how would they behave is very important. And especially for a country like ours, where we need to have the entrepreneurs to take risks of making investments. Otherwise, we'll have to create, we have to have a policy where we say that 90% of our economy would be agrarian. So all of us, we should get into agriculture, you know, become farmers and produce whatever it is, no risk, nothing has to be taken. You do menial work, be a farmer and be happy hereafter.
But rural demand is what the government is counting on, you know, going forward. Do you think the rural demand is here to stay, sir? And as an NBFC, which also does farm equipment financing, what are the trends that you are seeing are related to rural demand?
No, rural demand is picking up and it will pick up, but rural demand will be only limited to the extent of essentials, because rural demand will not go into supporting other industries. So let us suppose that if we say that we are only going to, as a country, we'll only have essentials as a model for our industrialization, then it is fine. Then rural demand is fine, but there has to be a blend of the rural and the urban demand. Both have to be there. And the urban demand and also industrialization is very important, because when we are talking about that our country is lagging behind of China because of industrialization. So therefore, then how do we promote industrialization? If we promote industrialization, entrepreneurs will need to take risks. If entrepreneurs are taking risks, there can be businesses which can go, also can go belly up, because when they take a risk, it is not that all the businesses are going to succeed. So if the business fails, then the entrepreneur is going to be hanged till death. So which entrepreneur will take that risk? So only the larger ones, which are very, very large companies, will become larger. So that is a model which as a country that we need to follow. Fine, that's good. That's not a bad model. But then, you know, I think that as a country, it is time now to decide that what should be our economic roadmap.
Given the, you know, growth contraction that the economy is likely to see this year in 2021, you know, what more do you want the government to do specific to, like, say, SMEs? You know, you've talked about sectors, but specific to SMEs, many have said that, you know, possibly because demand dries up, most of the SMEs may not, you know, be existent towards the end of December or next year, because, and then there will be a supply mismatch that will come.
No, definitely. I think that basically, as you very rightly said, that there would be many of the MSMEs will close down, many of the companies, and also we are now having restrictions on imports. So therefore, if we do not do something immediately, next year we'll see inflation. Because, so therefore, it will be basically a death knell for the people at large. So I think that's why I said that it is very important to have a practical roadmap laid down. The government may or may not announce, but internally there has to be a very clear economic roadmap that where as a country that we need to be going, who are going to be the constituents, how those constituents will be enabled. So these are the kind of thoughts, like today only I was seeing in one of the newspapers that there has been a committee of the government which has been set up. And there are so many hundreds of licenses which is required for a company. And each license, so therefore after a person, a company gets all these licenses, an entrepreneur should be nominated for the Nobel Prize.
So, as a firm which has done, which is doing asset financing, what are the trends that you are seeing, sir, in terms of, is there a pickup in construction activity? Is there a pickup in road building? What are the trends that you are seeing in terms of?
See, I am not seeing much of pickup in the work as such on the ground. So, road building, some pockets it is happening. It is not happening to the extent that we would like it to happen. The construction work also, there is a small pickup here and there, but it is not something which we can write home about, and it is going to take time. The realistic situation, it is going to take time because the companies themselves, they are constrained for cash because either the banks are not very eager to lend because they also know that there is a cash flow problem which the clients have. And most of the companies in the infrastructure space, excepting L&T and some of the large companies, most of the companies in the infra space have problems. Or their money is stuck up with the government, either through arbitration awards or bills. Because the government also, that once the case goes for an arbitration and an arbitration award comes in also, the government doesn't pay. They will go to the High Court, to the Supreme Court, and you keep on fighting. So the Arbitration Act itself is basically made into a damned squib, because in spite of the fact that an arbitration award is given, which is as per the agreement with the government and the constituent, still it is not respected. If it is not respected by the constituent, it is understandable. But if it is not respected by the government, then it is incomprehensible.
And the government,
where we have landed up.
And the government is known to not pay, right? And there are so many PSUs and so many government departments that owe a lot of money to MSMEs. So the government has been saying that most of these dues are within the 45-day permitted window and not, they don't really exceed that window.
No, but because of the disputes, you see, there's some dispute which is raised. The payments will not come in after the arbitration awards also, when the payment does not come in. You see, I can understand everything. But what I cannot understand is the violation of the sanctity of the arbitration award. Because we have so many clients whose money is stuck up with the government in spite of the fact they have the arbitration award. And the arbitration is usually the government, the agreements with the government says that arbitration, basically there are three people as arbitrators. One is appointed by the government, one is appointed by the client, another is appointed by both of them together, an independent person. So it's a very democratic process, which is aligned to the government's conditions in the agreement, which is again drawn up by the government. So I think that this is one particular area where the government really needs to think about it. Wherever the disputes are there, that how they can address the, have a quick redressal of the disputes, at least with the government. Because then as a conduct, the government is saying that, I am setting up a conduct which is appropriate. Then companies will start following, citizens will start following. So you see, everyone likes to emulate the leader. So in this case, it is the government. So the government as a leader says that, my conduct, that if I have signed an agreement, it will not be disputed. If I have entered into, I will not renege a contract which I have signed. It is not a piece of toilet paper. So I think that if it starts from the government, that respect for the contract, that respect for the arbitration award, that respect for any court orders which come in, so it will change the entire behavior of businesses in our country.
Right. And so, my last question, there's a lot of talk of a V-shaped recovery, a shallow U-shaped recovery, a W-shaped recovery. When, as someone who sees it much closer in terms of, your interaction with companies and with other borrowers, when do you see, what kind of a recovery do you see? And what steps do you want the government to take, at least, yes, you've talked about sectoral, but do you want the government to actually put money into the hands of the people also?
No, definitely. You see, the hands of the people through the Jan Dhan account, which is there, the NREGA program, which is there, all these are good programs. I'm not undermining the government and saying that they're not doing an excellent job on that. That is very much required. But at the same time, that how do you, the lives of people, and from the health perspective also, all the care which is being taken, these are very important things. And I would, the government has done a great job in all these areas. But at the same time, the livelihood also is important. So it is time to look at that how that livelihood can happen in a sustainable manner in an uncertain time. Because times are uncertain. But the livelihood has to be on a sustainable basis. So that is why we have to think out of the box at this juncture.
And we don't know what kind of a recovery will eventually come in, despite the different shapes that the economists talk about.
See, fortunately, I'm not an economist, so therefore, you know, I can't talk about a V-shape or a U-shape. I think that if we have a logical way that the economy, that people are in a position to have their livelihood going on, the businesses are able to survive and sustain themselves, the banks and the NBFCs are in a position to sustain themselves because they are able to get the necessary support. I'm not saying that, you know, you have to support everyone by infusing a lot of money. A lot of money infusion is not the model which I would recommend. I would not recommend a stimulus package model what Singapore or US or Europe has been able to do it, because they are rich countries. We are not. So within our means, what kind of a package that we should have? Is therefore, we have to think in a more practical and an intelligent manner than the other countries are, because they have a lot of money, so you don't have to be very intelligent. But when you have less money, then you have to be more intelligent, because then you use every penny in a wiser manner.
Right, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for your time and sharing with us what is actually happening in the financial sector and your thoughts on the economy. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for it. Thanks.